This is the Exxon Broadcast Network, broadcasting worldwide on broadcast affiliates and satellite program providers, including CNN Broadcast Network, Sirius Satellite Network, Star Media, Good News Radio Network, Angel Broadcast Network, Wiki Broadcast Network, and WPBN-TV. For more information on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, visit us at www.xzbn.net.
Take a step back in time and discover old Florida cuisine at Marsh Landing Restaurant in Fellsmere. Enjoy delicacies such as frog legs, gator tail, catfish, and swamp cabbage, or enjoy the more traditional cuisine like hand-cut Angus steaks, ribs, and seafood. Join us for breakfast with a southern flair featuring sweet potato pancakes, biscuits and gravy, and much more. Planning a party? Marsh Landing's private dining room can accommodate groups from 8 to 80 people. While you're visiting, enjoy the historic pictures, artifacts, and stories that line the walls. Marsh Landing is truly a unique experience. Marsh Landing Restaurant, 44 North Broadway in historic Fellsmere, or visit marshlandingrestaurant.com. Marsh Landing, old Florida cuisine at its best.
Good evening and welcome to Paranormal Stakeout. I'm your host, Larry Lawson, on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, www.xzbn.net. Got a great show for you tonight, folks. Really interesting topic. But you know, all the years I've been a police detective, I've been trained, hardwired, if you will, to present evidence that can be touched, seen, understood by a jury as I'm telling my story during a prosecution of a crime. But tonight's topic is anything but that tangible. In fact, it's just the opposite in so many ways, yet it's profoundly changed how I personally look at a lot of things in life. And that topic is synchronicity and coincidence. And tonight to discuss that topic with us is Mr. Doug Dillon. Doug is a husband, father, grandfather, 30-year public school educator from the Orlando, Florida area, author, public speaker, and paranormal explorer. Doug's work with high-risk students as a teacher and later as a school administrator helped set the stage for his journey into the paranormal as he helped others learn and understand what that world that is beyond our own. In 1979, a chain of events in Doug's life started he and his wife on a spiritual voyage that led to the development of Doug's wife's ability as a trance medium. It also led to his understanding of the spirit world and its effect on our lives. Doug's careful research and documentation into the paranormal has allowed him to compile such an extensive database that he's been able to author his first book, An Explosion of Being, An American Family's Journey into the Psychic. Since then, Doug has been the guest of television and radio hosts, and he continues to write on the subject, including his latest book, Carl Jung, Hauntings and Paranormal Coincidences. Doug is also completing his paranormal historical fiction series for young adults titled The St. Augustine Trilogy. Doug's work with synchronicity, coincidence, and the spirit world has led him to new levels of understanding the world we live in. His website is www.DougDillon.com. And Doug, welcome to the show tonight.
Hey, Larry, thank you. It's good to be here. We've been talking about this for a while, and it's time to do it.
That it is. Such an interesting topic. And for an old flatfoot like me, who's used to tangible evidence, this is kind of a new world for me, but a really, really important one. But why don't you start off by telling our audience a little bit about how you began your path into the paranormal. How did you start?
Well, this goes way back to, as you said, the year 1979. And my wife and I were living our lives. I was a school administrator, and she was a stay-at-home mom with our kids, and we had no involvement with the psychic, with the paranormal, even religion, nothing like that at all. And then suddenly when my dad died, a couple of things happened that startled me so much. My mom said, "Dad, Doug, this is your dad is trying to contact you," which I didn't believe. And what had happened is I was working with my mom, and my dad was a retired Air Force officer, so we had a couple of Air Force people at her house getting his military benefits settled, when in the middle of that, all of a sudden, his Ford out in the parking lot right on the other side of the house started, the horn just started blowing like somebody was leaning on it. I had to go out and unplug the horn, and it just really startled me, but I figured it was hot out. It must be something electrical. No problem at all. So the next day, I took Dad's car to go to the Social Security office, plugged the horn back in. It was fine. I got to the Social Security office, and the damn horn started blaring again. As just as I walked in front of it again, I had to pull the plugs. And that was the only two times that the car did that. But those two coincidental events got me thinking my mom may have been right. So my wife and I went to Casadega, visited some mediums, and started our whole journey at that point.
Any chance the car horn could have been a short or anything like that?
It could have been. I mean, I don't know for sure, but those events, even I realized that logically because I'm a very logical person, but we proceeded there to go to Casadega and visit a medium my mom had been to, and I didn't believe in them at all. And this woman told me so many things, even said, "You got a clock in your house that's not working. It's on the wall, and it's going to start working in 3 days." We did have an electric clock on the wall, and in 3 days, it did begin working after not working for about 6 months. So from there, we got involved with automatic writing. Barb actually did some work with the Ouija board, and then she developed the ability to contact her soul, other entities, whatever you want to say, and we had all kinds of information start flowing.
Well, and I'm really, really interested in heading down that path and finding out on this journey that you took. We're going to take a break in just a couple of seconds, but I do want to mention your website again, www.dougdillon.com. Your books, the St. Augustine Trilogy and Carl Jung, Hauntings and Paranormal Coincidences. Good read, and I want to recommend that to everybody. So we're going to take a quick break here. See you on the other side. Paranormal Stakeout.
This is the Exxon Broadcast Network, broadcasting worldwide on broadcast affiliates and satellite program providers, including CNN Broadcast Network, Sirius Satellite Network, Star Media, Good News Radio Network, Angel Broadcast Network, Wiki Broadcast Network, and WPBN-TV. For more information on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, visit us at www.xzbn.net.
How would you like to be able to read other people's minds? Well, the next best thing is here. When you know how to read a person's name, you know how the person thinks, feels, and behaves. Each letter in our name holds a key to unlock our true essence. Our name contains both our gifts and challenges in this lifetime. Nemology science discovers personality secrets hidden in the placement of the letters of our names, including the first and last impression people remember about us. Sharon shows us how to interpret the arrangement of letters as outlined in her book, Know the Name, Know the Person. Sharon Lynn Wyeth created Nemology Science after 18 years of research and testing her theories and has supported thousands of people around the world in understanding themselves and others better. You'll enjoy Sharon's unique teachings as she shares her system to learn the gifts behind your given birth name. Even if you don't like your birth name, there are jewels in this book. If you're thinking of changing your name, ready to name your child, or wanting to get along better with others, this is the book for you. If you'd like to improve your relationships and change your life for the better, get the book today, Know the Name, Know the Person, or visit www.knowthename.com. That's www.knowthename.com.
Take a step back in time and discover old Florida cuisine at Marsh Landing Restaurant in Fellsmere, Florida. Enjoy delicacies such as frog legs, gator tail, catfish, and swamp cabbage, or enjoy the more traditional cuisine such as hand-cut Angus steaks, ribs, and seafood. Join us for breakfast with a southern flair featuring sweet potato pancakes, biscuits and gravy, and much more. Planning a party? Marsh Landing's private dining rooms can accommodate groups from 8 to 80 people. While you visit, enjoy the historic pictures, artifacts, and stories that line the walls. Marsh Landing is truly a unique experience. Marsh Landing Restaurant, 44 North Broadway in historic downtown Fellsmere. Or visit marshlandingrestaurant.com. Marsh Landing, old Florida cuisine at its best. Welcome back to Paranormal Stakeout and our guest, Doug Dillon. Doug, we got off to a really good start there, hearing a lot about how you ended up heading down the path of paranormal study and research. Talked a little bit about your dad. Go a little bit further into what happened in Casadega.
Well, Casadega is a spiritualist community, and there was a woman there who has since died, May Graves Ward. And we had never met her before, walked into her house, and she sat us down, and immediately the first thing that really grabbed my attention is she said, well, yeah, you're here because of your father, but your grandfather is actually here with you right now. And, of course, At that time I wasn't too sure that was the case. She said she's holding up his hand, and on his hand he has a ring, and he's showing that you come from good family. My grandfather was a member of the Masons before he died, had given me his Masonic ring, which sat at home in my dresser. So that, along with a bunch of other things, she had told us about our daughter and having ear problems, just event after event, and we got done with all that. We said, my God, I guess we really do need to investigate this in a little more depth.
Yeah, I actually had a similar experience that you had with a medium, and I didn't believe it at all until some of the information that came out was absolutely startling. So I can really understand where you're coming from.
It wakes you up.
Yeah, it did. It really, really did.
Yeah.
Once you got on this path, did your involvement in the paranormal ever cause problems? I mean, issues with your family, personal life, anything like that?
Well, you know, back in those days, a lot of people did not believe in the paranormal. We didn't have ghost hunting shows on TV. Barb and I just never thought about that. We got all involved in our explorations over 3 years, and then we decided to put all that material from her work with the channeling and wrote a book that you already mentioned, The Explosion of Being, and that was picked up by Prentice Hall, and they set us up with a bunch of radio and TV shows, which we did across the country, which was a great deal of fun. What happened is we both lost friends because of that process. I had a close friend at work who was in my school administrator of work, who was a fellow administrator. And before I left the school system to go into business with a friend, and I told her about my work with the paranormal, and she immediately dropped me as a friend. Turned out that she was involved with a large church in Orlando whose minister believed that everything that was involved with the paranormal was evil. And the same thing happened to my wife. She had a good friend she hadn't seen in years, came to the house, we had dinner, and told her and her husband about the paranormal, and bam, we lost her as a friend. So, especially in those days, people were not too receptive.
Well, that's a shame. I've had other friends that have had that issue happen to them also. I want to start talking a little bit about synchronicity, coincidences, and I want to really focus on the book that you wrote, Carl Jung, Hauntings and Paranormal Coincidences. That's really kind of an interesting mix of words and ideas. Can you give us a little bit of a synopsis of what you've written there and why?
Sure. You know, after Barb and I wrote that book so many years ago, and as time went on, I started looking at those events and realizing how many of them were coincidental and how many of them were a series of coincidences that actually led to more information in different directions that Barb and I took. And eventually, in the 1990s, I got deeply involved in meditation, a Buddhist form of meditation, and I guess that tended to open me up to more coincidences because they kept arriving in big, big batches. And then I read about Carl Jung, and Carl Jung, back in the early 1900s, had noticed in his psychiatric work that coincidences happened a lot to him and to other people and had specific purpose. And so he called that synchronicity, and I started investigating his work and found that this guy was not only interested in coincidences and hauntings and all kinds of paranormal stuff. So I took some of his work, his experiences, and put it together with other events that had happened in my life and other people's life that I really trusted, and how that related to hauntings and paranormal events, and said, you know, let me just put this together for a short, quick book that people could look at and maybe relate to the experiences that they're having in their lives, and it would give them some information, and that's how it began.
Well, give me an example of a coincidence in your life that you were able to relate to a haunting or something involved with the paranormal. Can you do that?
Sure. One was, what happened with me is that I get a whole series of events. And this one time, I was staring out at my window in my office where I do my writing, and there was a little stained glass piece that had come from my mom's house, and she had died several years before. And in that stained glass was a picture of a hummingbird, was an actual hummingbird. And I was staring at that hummingbird and thinking about my mom, and from out of the yard came a hummingbird, and the hummingbird sat motionless right behind that stained glass hummingbird and then flew off, which startled the living heck out of me. And I thought, yeah, maybe that's a sign. Maybe not. Maybe my mom's thinking about me. And I kind of let that go because it could or couldn't be. I didn't know. But I decided to put that in a blog post on my website and called it Infinite Hummingbirds, something like that, and posted it, put it on Facebook, put it on Twitter, and just threw it out there to tell people what had happened. And then the next day I went on the Internet, and somehow I was checking on my name. Sometimes you check your name and you see what's going on with your books, and I put Doug Dillon in the search and came up with a Facebook page which said Doug Dillon, and it had this beautiful hummingbird on it. And I thought, wait a minute, that's not what I posted. And then I realized it was the actual homepage of the Facebook of another Doug Dillon. And so the relationship to a Doug Dillon with my name and then with the hummingbird was startling. So I looked this guy up in his Facebook page and got information, and I got in touch with him. And it turns out that I live in Central Florida. He lives in North Florida. I was a school administrator. He was a school administrator. And we started comparing notes, and the number of things that were comparable to both of us was astounding. And the thing that, to wrap this up quickly, he had told me that, you know what, now I remember you. I said, what do you mean you remember me? He said, well, you know, I live in North Florida, but I had some business with a school board in Orange County where you work. And I was in your school board office one day several years ago, and I walked by an office, and there was your name, which was my name. I walked in there. You were not there. And I asked people, you know, how can I get in touch with this Doug Dillon? Somehow that never happened. But the event of him actually going to my office just capped it off beautifully. So those are the kind of things that happen and just startle me.
What is the most significant coincidence that you've had? I mean, things happen. We all experience that in life, deja vu, things happening that seem to be a coincidence. But what is the most significant coincidence that you've had?
Oh, boy, there's so many, Larry. One, I guess, was relating to my meditation practice, because periodically I go on retreat, and meditation retreats where we go off for a week or so. And there's a spot that we go to in Brooksville. It's called Chincoket Hill. It's the second highest hill in the state of Florida. It's a beautiful place, and the first time I went there, I saw that it had an old plantation mansion from 1842, 1843, and I had been starting my novels for young adults called the St. Augustine Trilogy, which involves the Second Seminole War, which occurred the 7 years just before this mansion was built. So I thought, wow, that's kind of an interesting coincidence. And the first day of the retreat, I walked out of the meditation hall and looked up. There are a lot of trees all around. And I looked up at those trees, and I thought, boy, there's a bunch of branches up in the tops of the trees that had not been trimmed. It looked like they could fall any minute. So I thought worried me a little bit, but I said, nah, I'm sure there's no problem. So I decided to take a walk, and down the main road, this dirt road that you can walk on and do some walking meditation. And I decided to use my imagination and talk mentally to the person who created that plantation. And as I was doing this, this mental image of a man in period dress came up, and I knew, of course, it was my imagination. But at the end, he said something to the effect of, "Suffer the little children to come unto me." And I thought, what? You know, that's straight from Jesus. I'm not a Christian. I gave up Christianity a long time ago, and it made no sense. So I was came back toward the meditation hall and found, to my amazement, there was a little cemetery there for the people who had died at that time. And sure enough, here was a little grave, and that gravestone had a little lamb on it. It was a child's grave, and on that it had the words, "Suffer the little children to come unto me." And, of course, that startled the heck out of me. And so I decided to just go ahead and have dinner with a group. At that night, I wasn't that hungry, but had dinner. I'm still looking at those crazy branches up in the trees, but I said, after dinner, I'm just going to sit in this bench out in the middle of where all the houses are that we could have, that we stayed at. And sitting there meditating, and all of a sudden, this tremendous crash behind me, and a huge tree branch had broken off the tree right above me, had missed me by about 10 feet. If I'd been underneath that branch, it would have either badly damaged my head or killed me, one or the other. In fact, another meditator across the way about 100 feet yelled out to me, "Are you okay?" And I was, but I was sure startled that the whole idea of these coincidences fitting together, whether that really saved my life or was just precognitive, I don't know. But those series were fascinating, and I just love that story. I tell it everywhere I go.
Okay. Well, we've got the term synchronicity, and we've got coincidences. Explain right. The differences and similarities between the two, if you could.
Yeah, coincidences, things that just happen and don't link up in any way. Really, Carl Jung put synchronicity as this new word because it really says that there are two things that happen at the same time that seem, kind of related, but actually have no apparent connections. And so you can have one event, and one event is one thing, and statistically you can dismiss that. But when you have multiplicities of these things, like the story I just told, about the tree branch, then those things together indicate there's something else going on, that subconsciously or through our soul or spirit, whatever, we are connected to the totality of the universe, and that we do gather information, and that can give you information about what you're doing and where you might want to be going.
Okay. All right. What I really would like to get into more with you is how this topic and the spirit world connect with each other. Can you kind of give me a brief explanation on that connection?
Well, for the last 20 years, I've been deeply involved in physics and trying to understand subatomic physics. And when I read that stuff, it says the same thing that Buddhist teachers do, that everything is connected. And if everything is connected, then the spirit world, if you believe in that, is connected as well. And the coincidences are just indicators of that spirit world. And if we open ourselves up to that, which I finally ended up doing, I finally said, all right, let it happen, then there is a blending from my observation and my experiences of having events happen that are coincidental and precognitive and hauntings, and they all fit together.
Well, when we come back after the next break, I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about that. I want to hear a little bit more about your wife's automatic writing and how that fits into this big, big scheme. So okay. When we come back from the break, we're going to talk about it. I'm with Doug Dillon.
This is the Exxon Broadcast Network, broadcasting worldwide on broadcast affiliates and satellite program providers, including CNN Broadcast Network, Sirius Satellite Network, Star Media, Good News Radio Network, Angel Broadcast Network, Wiki Broadcast Network, and WPBN-TV. For more information on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, visit us at www.xzbn.net.
While science pursues fact, magic accesses the quantum level, bridging random facts to form truth. As long as science and magic remain separate and polarized, the truth cannot be known. I'm Gwilda Wiecka. Join me on the Science of Magic radio program, dedicated to unification and evolution of consciousness. During each episode, I'll be speaking with experienced and respected scientists and mystics. From astrologers to astronomers, from medical doctors to shaman, the scientific method to dowsing and intuition, we'll weave together information from seemingly divergent practices to promote unity and enlightenment. Join me, Gwilda Wiecka, and the Science of Magic right here on the Mutual Broadcast Network. For more information, visit www.thescienceofmagic.net.
Gibbs A. Williams, Ph.D., is a practicing psychoanalyst, supervisor, researcher, and author in New York City. Much of his life has been dedicated to understanding nature and the uses of meaningful coincidences or synchronicities. His radical and original non-Jungian, non-mystical, non-magical theory of synchronicities illuminates much of the fog surrounding this challenging and perplexing topic. His ideas and manners are fresh, presented in a style that is both entertaining and highly informative. He is also an expert on crisis intervention, specially focused on violence reduction for the police and citizens, mastering anxiety, frustration, and stress without the use of medication, and effectively preventing and treating heroin addiction. Dr. Williams can be contacted at his email address at gwwilliamsny11@aol.com or visit his website at
Did you know that when you're on the road with limited data or Wi-Fi, you can still listen to the X-Zone radio show with Rob McConnell, The Science of Magic with Gwilda Wiecka, X-1, Dimension X, Space Patrol, and every minute of the X-Zone broadcast network by calling 213-401-0080, courtesy of Audio Now. No smartphone, app, or internet needed. It saves your data plan, and it's free if you have unlimited minutes. Call 213-401-0080 to listen on any phone, anytime, anywhere. Remember, 213-401-0080 for the best of the paranormal, parapsychology, and sci-fi radio programming anywhere, 24/7, 365.
True healing must address four levels: physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual, for us to live joyful and productive lives. We tend to treat three of the four, leaving the spiritual languishing. If you're tired of the same dysfunctional patterns cropping up in your life, Soul Balancing is for you. Trixie Phelps, owner and founder of Soul Balancing, is a naturally gifted energy healer trained in numerous esoteric forms, including shamanism. Trixie has created a powerful modality that safely and effectively clears your energetic field. A Soul Balancing session can remove interference, heal trauma, and restore your hope. Contact Trixie for a life-changing long-distance session today, www.soulbalancing.world.
Welcome Welcome back to Paranormal Stakeout. This is your host, Larry Lawson, and we're with Doug Dillon tonight talking about synchronicity and coincidence. Doug, just before we went to the break, started to talk to you a little bit about your wife, her involvement with automatic writing, synchronicity, coincidence, and hauntings.
Right.
I'd like to hear a little bit more about that and your wife's journey down this road and how this automatic writing came into play.
Well, this goes way back into, as I say, the late 70s, the early 80s. My wife's involvement was from the point that we got involved with a medium. We did a lot of reading about connecting with the spirit world to see how valid this was and then if we could actually do it. And so she read about automatic writing where you just hold a pen or a pencil on a piece of paper and start scribbling and just let it go. And so she tried that, and eventually the scribble turned into words, even though she kept her eyes shut. So we would go back and then parse that stuff out to get words, and pretty soon the words started flowing in great numbers. And then eventually she said, you know what, I can just speak this stuff. So she would actually speak the words, and I would ask questions. It could be about anything, and ask questions, and then she would respond from what we eventually called the source, because we didn't know if this was her soul talking to us, another entity. It said it was another entity, but we just decided to call it the source. And what we did is just ask all kinds of questions about life and death and disease and disasters. And I would ask the questions while she was in trance, and then we would write these things down. And then periodically something would happen during those trance situations. In fact, one time I was writing words down that Barb had just given me, and I noticed a shadow, like a form of a human, standing next to me, which really startled me. It was just a shadow, almost a dark shadow, and then it was gone. And I told Barb in her trance, I said, you know what? I've just seen something, and I don't know what it is. Could you ask the source? And the source told her, and in her words, that is your mother, Barbara. Her mother lived near us. Your mother is sleeping right now. She is in an out-of-body situation. She has just stopped by to see what you're doing. So those are the kind of things that happen all the time, and that's why it made for a good book, and we put all that good stuff in there.
Were you ever able to do anything or conduct any type of experiment that could verify that these messages were coming from the other side?
No, never had anything. We never really pursued that. We just wanted, the information felt so good that we actually used some of that eventually there was a situation where we used to go to the Weekiver River, which is near us, and do a lot of canoeing. We felt very attached to the Weekiver River way before we started all this work with the paranormal, but the river got so close to us, we actually used an island on the river when we would start our sessions. Barb and I, we would think about that island and about being a paranormal paradise. And later on, what we found out through the writings was, the writings said that Barb and I had actually been Native Americans living in that area, and a lot of people who lived in that area now were Native Americans at the time and had settled on the banks of those rivers to experience some of the past. And we didn't really necessarily believe all that, but we went to the river one day and I looked in the water, and by gosh, there were little bits of pottery. And so we dug our hands into the sand and pulled out this pottery. We pulled out bones. Barb put her hand in at random and pulled out a beautiful spearhead. So I guess that's the closest thing to physical evidence that we came up with.
So what you're saying is your trip, your visits into the spiritual world have basically explained to you that life is just never ending and that we keep coming back? Is that what I'm hearing?
Absolutely. Of course, this says reincarnation, but when Barb was doing a lot of her sessions, she really came up with an image that I kind of crystallized. And talking about crystal, it was like a cut crystal, that the soul is like a cut crystal with many facets. And so each facet is a lifetime or a different dimension or a different universe. And this fits, of course, with all the physics that I was talking about. And so the whole idea is that we have multiple things that are maybe even going on right now. This life, and you and I are talking, and we get connected by a coincidence. Maybe that comes from a different universe. Things go on like that, so life is not this one little minute thing that we're dealing with. It's multiplicity of things, and the more we can conceive of it that way, the more we'll understand. And my experience has been the more that we understand that and believe it and think about it, then the more experiences we have as well.
Okay, synchronicity connects us to the spirit world on purpose, correct?
Yep, I believe it does. Now, where that comes from, I'm not sure. Again, it could be your soul, subconscious, it could be other entities, all those things together. And to try to parse that out and say exactly where it's coming from, we got to prove it, that just kills it when you try to do that stuff. So we've been basically accepting that, and it just helps me keep going. Barb went away from the work that we did back when she went to work. She was a stay-at-home mom when she began all this, but then she went to work, and that from that point on, she really went away from all this. I have kept it up, but periodically she did a few of these readings, like the one with a spearhead, and that just kind of brought us right back to the reality that we know.
Okay. Well, let's shift gears just a little bit here. I'd like to know if you've ever experienced a haunting, I guess, for lack of a better term, in the traditional sense.
Yeah, sure. Actually, I hadn't gotten very much of that in the work that we did until a few years ago, and I call it the bathroom ghost. And the reason is that a friend of mine had some events going on in his house that he wanted to bring in some ghost hunters. And the ghost hunters, you know, Larry, that we've talked to, Mary Jo and Greg, and said, could you come over to my house because you're interested in this stuff? And I said, sure. He wanted me to be there kind of as a buffer because he wasn't sure he believed all this stuff. And so I wanted to take my camera with me. And I'd never really taken pictures much in the dark, so this was at the end of the day. It was still a little bit light out. I shut the light off in my bathroom. It was pretty dark. I stuck my hand in the bathroom and just clicked a couple of pictures. When I took them out, my digital camera, there was this hazy shape as if someone was standing there. And it was very startling because all the other pictures didn't have that, but this one picture did. And I showed that picture to the ghost hunters, and they said, wow, they'd never see anything like that. My son's a professional photographer, and he could not find a physical reason for that to happen. And so a few years later, my son, my wife, and I were sitting in our family room, and we heard something drop in the foyer near us and bounce, and it turned out there was an owl that was set into our fake tree. It was a fake owl that somehow had popped off that tree and hit the floor and bounced. And that made me think, too, what is there something going on here? And the only reason we could think for that bathroom ghost and this owl might have been that Barb's mom had died in the room that I use currently as my office, and maybe with our opening up more and more, maybe that was showing something. And so a couple of days after that, some people were in that family room with me, and I looked into the hallway and saw a shadow head come out of the hallway, look around as if there was looking around for something, and as I looked at it, it looked like it had was startled. There was a shaking of the head, and it popped back into the shadows again. So I thought, wow, that's interesting, and maybe there is something going on here.
Well, go ahead.
You know, then a few weeks later, my son brought his dog over and let us keep his dog for a while. And the dog kept growling in that hallway, and I thought, well, I wonder if that dog is sensing something, because dogs often do that. I brought the dog into the family room and then into the kitchen with Barb. The dog kept growling, and I said, I don't know, maybe this dog is sensing the ghost, if there is one. And just then, all the lights in the house dimmed incredibly low. You see that on TV. You see it in movies, but I've never seen it in my house. The lights dimmed, held that way for a few minutes. I could hear the refrigerator sputtering, and then the lights went back on. The dog stopped barking. That's my story.
Interesting. Interesting. Well, how do you relate the spiritual world, synchronicity, spirits, reincarnation, with ghosts? How do you connect the two?
Well, a lot of times we have these events that really are the hauntings. The visions that you see really are coincidences when you look at them. And so I think if we expand, especially for people who are investigators, expand precognition and expand hauntings and visions that people see and realize they are coincidences, the coincidental events at that particular time, then that recognition, in my view and in my experience in my life, has actually brought about more events like that, which can then lead you in various directions. You got to be careful, though, because you don't want to say, oh, it's leading in me directions, and then this is for sure, and I'm invested with this, and I'm going to spend money on it, and I'm going to go for that, change my life. And you got to be careful, because you might find yourself going in a wrong direction, because sometimes what happens with these events is that the more we think about them, the more we help to create them, because everything I know says that we help to create the reality around us, that we help to bring about coincidences, that we help to bring about hauntings. And so that's the connectivity, as long as you don't take it too far and look for a lot of guidance in your life, because then you can go off in the deep end.
Interesting. So what's a ghost then?
A ghost is a discarnate entity, in my view, most of the time, someone who has lived at some point. But just like the event I told you when Barb and I were doing the channeling and I was taking notes and I saw something that I would have called a ghost, but the source told us, no, that's not a ghost, that is somebody in an out-of-body situation. So you can have a ghost, somebody, an individual that has lived at some point. In fact, I've had some people who are more attuned than I am say you can even have future entities coming, talking to you, or they can be out-of-body experiences as well.
Okay. Well, we're about ready to hit our last break, and when we get back, I want to explore this a little bit more, the connection between ghosts that perhaps paranormal investigators seek and the spiritual world. I want to talk more about that. I want to get more of your view on that when we come back after this break. I'm with Doug Dillon, www.dougdillon.com, and we'll be back right after these messages here.
On Broadcast Network, broadcasting worldwide on broadcast affiliates and satellite program providers, including CNN Broadcast Network, Sirius Satellite Network, Star Media, Good News Radio Network, Angel Broadcast Network, Wiki Broadcast Network, and WPBN-TV. For more information on the X Zone Broadcast Network, visit us at www.xzbn.net.
Did you know that when you're on the road with limited data or Wi-Fi, you can still listen to the X-Zone Radio Show with Rob McConnell, The Science of Magic with Gwilda Wiaka, X-1, Dimension X, Space Patrol, and every minute of the X-Zone Broadcast Network by calling 213 213-
401-0080, courtesy of Audio Now. No smartphone, app, or internet needed. It saves your data plan, and it's free if you have unlimited minutes. Call 213-401-0080 to listen on any phone, anytime, anywhere. Remember, 213-401-0080 for the best of the paranormal, parapsychology, and sci-fi radio programming anywhere, 24/7, 365.
I am Dr. Carl O'Helvey, founder, president of a new cancer foundation focusing on evidence-based physical, mental, and spiritual interventions, including natural cancer cures, prayer, meditation, affirmations, nutrition, and other related holistic cancer prevention and cure modalities. These are used in cancer education, research, and financing care. I ask for your help to continue this important work by donating at www.holisticcancerfoundation.com.
Wouldn't you love to know the secret to everything? Well then, meet Dr. Kimberly McGeorge and her cutting-edge breakthrough knowledge that combines science with possibility. Dr. Kimberly brings real-life answers and healing to those open to alternative solutions. She teaches solution-based programs and classes that will change all areas of your life forever. Specializing in conscious creation, intuitive readings, and energy medicine, you can rapidly shift health, relationships, business, and money and abundance challenges quickly. Receive her best-selling book, Secret to Everything, at no cost by going to secrettoeverything.com/X-Zone. That's right. Transformation can start now. Just go to secrettoeverything.com/X-Zone and receive Dr. Kimberly's book for free.
Little children aren't the only ones afraid of the dark. Millions of soldiers return from war zones with PTSD, anger, frustration, fear, and loneliness, much of which surfaces during the darkness of the night. You have the chance to change the lives of these American heroes. Songs and Stories for Soldiers.us provides free MP3 players for these men and women. With a list of 3 million songs in 16 different styles, 100,000 audiobooks, and 30,000 old-time radio programs, every veteran can find something to soothe and comfort them at no cost. All our players contain an 8-hour audio program designed to help veterans fall asleep. With 1,500 plus vets now participating, it's our goal to deliver 10,000 audio players this year. Go to our website at songsandstoriesforsoldiers.us. Help us help a veteran make it through the night.
You're listening to the X-Zone Broadcast Network, www.xzbn.net.
Welcome back to Paranormal Stakeout. I'm Larry Lawson, your host, and we're with Doug Dillon tonight. And we're on the X-Zone Broadcasting Network, www.xzbn.net. And we're with Doug, and his website is www.dougdillon.com. Doug, we're having a great conversation tonight, and I'm really interested in some of your points of view, because there are many different ones out there. Tell me again how you reconcile the ghosts that the investigators look for, as compared to the spirit world. Again, help me with that and reconcile the similarities and differences there, if you can.
I don't see any difference. I mean, what investigators are doing is going to a specific location to uncover things that are unusual that people have experienced, but it could be the same type of thing in their own lives. It's the same type of things that you and I have been talking about. Hauntings, mm-hmm. precognitions, and then all kinds of events. And so one thing, though, I would suggest, and that is sometimes investigators see the paranormal and even the coincidences as way over there. I see a paranormal investigator sitting on the edge of the Grand Canyon looking to the other side saying, oh yeah, those are the things way over there. But based on physics and based on Buddhism and everything that I have learned, the connectivity, there is no gap between the observer and that's what's being observed. I think that if paranormal investigators were to understand that more and forget that realize there is no gulf, then I think they would have a richer experience and be able to have a better experience for their clients. Because a lot of times what paranormal investigators do is rely on their equipment. Now, equipment is beautiful. I wish we'd had equipment when I first got into this stuff, and I could use that, but I'd never had it. But if you over-rely on that, it separates you from the phenomena that you're investigating. So I think that if paranormal investigators were to be more open for these things and to realize they're part of it, that as they observe, they're connected to it, I think that they'll have a richer experience. I think that they'll have more events happen. I think that they will understand better to be able to give a client a better understanding of what's happened. So that's the kind of thing that I think that connectivity will be very beneficial to people, whether they use paranormal investigation equipment or not.
So it's the openness. Now, you take a guy like me. I don't consider myself sensitive in the sense of being able to feel things. So therefore, I rely on equipment. I rely on hard evidence. That's just, you know, how I am, how I'm trained.
Sure.
So how do I then, how to say this, how do I get that opportunity or that ability to feel things beyond the equipment? Because normally I don't.
It doesn't mean necessarily that you're going to feel anything. I'm not a sensitive either, but what my life experience says that I have events happen to me. There are those people who are psychics and mediums who are sensitive and can tell you things, but I'm not that either. But I want to experience more so that I understand more. And I've seen people do this, go to Casadega and study with the mediums and become more sensitive, but that's not what I'm about. I'm about using the mind that I have now, and I'm a very hard-ass person as well, thinking about just the logic of the situation, whether things make sense or not. And so I just do the same thing, Larry. I say, well, let me get the evidence, but then let's put this together and see if it makes sense, if it is a benefit. And really, as I said before, is the openness. If you believe that the openness that you can conjure up will allow you to experience more, and that you say to the universe, your higher power, God, whatever, I'm ready to receive what you got. And the more that happens, and if you're a religious person, praying, meditating like I do, those type of things are what can open you up if you think that that is logical from what you've experienced, what you've heard me say, what you've read, and go on from there.
Well, can we go back to Jung for just a second? How does Jung's theory fit into that?
Well, synchronicity he was using synchronicity as really a psychiatric tool, but he also had enough haunting events in his life that he believed that they, as I understand it, that they fit together, and that the synchronicity events, he actually could use that within his psychiatric practice. And the one, to me, that was the most fascinating was that a young woman who she knew she needed some help, but she was really didn't want to listen to what Jung had to say. And this one day in his office, she was telling him about a dream she had, and she was droning on about this scarab beetle, you know, the kind that you see in Egyptian tombs and things. And she was droning on, and behind him at a window, something kept tapping at the window. And behind Jung, and it was disturbing him. Whatever that was, it was disturbing him. He finally looked over, went to the window, and here was a giant, great big large green beetle that was really a scarab beetle. He opened the window. It was the same type of beetle the woman was talking about. He was able to grab the beetle. He brought it to her, and he said, "Here is the scarab that you were just talking about." And from that point on, she began to get better and to actually listen to him. So those type of events, and I think the hauntings that he experienced in his own life also opened him up to the synchronicity. That's just my assumption. I don't think I have read that he said that, but that's what it looks like to me.
So Jung was a believer in ghosts. He was a believer in the paranormal.
Oh, yeah, because he had so many events that startled the heck out of him, and he wrote about them.
How did that go with the psychiatric community around him at that time?
Well, not very well, because not a lot of people believe that. People who believed in the paranormal were not looked upon too well. But, of course, this was the time of Freud, and Freud was the big man in the psychiatric world. And Jung really wanted Freud to accept and understand his theories of synchronicity, understand the paranormal. So he went to visit Freud one day and was talking to Freud about all the details of synchronicity and hauntings and trying to get him to understand. And all the time, Jung is shaking his head, obviously not accepting what Jung had to say. And during that time, Jung started getting a feeling in his solar plexus, a lot of pressure, a lot of heat. And at that moment, a huge explosion rang out of a big bookcase right behind Freud. It was like a gunshot, kapow, startling both men. And then Jung realizing that this was a synchronistic event, that nothing actually happened. They investigated the bookcase. There was nothing wrong with the bookcase. And so Jung started talking to Freud again about his synchronicity and hauntings. And he said, "This was an example. You just experienced that." And Freud is saying, no, that's not true. And at that point, Jung started getting the same feeling again in his solar plexus. And he said, "You need to realize that that event is going to happen again." And as he said that, another explosion rang out from that bookcase and startled both men, but not Jung as much, because he realized and had told Freud what was going to happen. But yet Freud did not accept that. Jung left without the blessing that he wanted from Freud. But it was only later, many years later, that Freud came back and started investigating and looking into what Jung had to say, and agreed that Jung was right. But it took a long, long time.
Well, I got to be honest with you. I've had some things occur in my life that are starting to make me rethink this theory of synchronicity. I got to admit, fascinating, very, very fascinating topic. And all this is well and good. I can see where it can be useful, but what kind of problems can synchronicity cause?
Well, if you believe in it too much, and if you get hooked into what you think you want, if I have all these synchronistic events and I'm thinking, aha, this is going to help me in selling more books, and I've got to do this, this, and that as what synchronicity is pointing towards, and if I spend a lot of money and a lot of time and a lot of effort, I can end up in the deep end and spend all the time and energy for nothing, because sometimes that's a sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy. So you've got to come back and look logically at yourself and say, you know, can you separate yourself from that? Because sometimes people don't, and this happens often in the religious community, and they will see coincidences, omens, and say, well, that's the word of God, and God is telling us that the world's going to end next week or in a month or a year from now. And people go out and sell their homes and go out on the mountaintop and wait for God to end the world. And then when it doesn't happen, they realize that all those synchronous events may not have been the word of God. And a lot of times, as I've said before, if you are thinking about and accepting synchronous events, even if you're thinking in a religious way, sometimes you create some. And the more you create and you accept that and you believe it's the word of God and somebody's telling you what to do, then you're in trouble. So you've got to come back and take a very whole, cold, hard look and like a policeman, right, Larry?
You got it. So regardless of what side you're on, where you believe, you've got to be able to use common sense and not let your imagination run wild.
You got common sense. Yep.
Couldn't agree more. Doug, it's been a great show tonight. Really appreciate you being on. I want to again mention your website, www.dougdillon.com, your books, explosion of being and American families' journey into the psychic, and certainly Carl Jung's Hauntings and Paranormal Coincidences are great reads, and I do recommend them. I do want to tell my listeners, please check out our program schedule at www.xzbn.net for all the shows, all the great shows on the X Zone Broadcasting Network. It's been a great time, folks. We'll see you next week on Paranormal Stakeout.